Mount McKinley, 20,320 feet high, almost 4 miles, the tallest mountain in all of North America. The Athabascan Indians called it Denali, the Great One. It dominates a great buckling of the earth known as the Alaska Range, which was formed by two huge floating plates of the planet's surface relentlessly smashing into one another for thousands of years. These mountains play a large part in creating the more extreme temperatures and lower precipitation of Alaska's interior. They serve as a barrier to entire weather systems from the Gulf of Alaska, and immense masses of clouds build and swirl along their southern flanks. Icy and aloof, Denali and its neighbors are a source of wonder for all who see them, a challenge for those who wish to climb them. In 1917, Denali and the rich wildlife resources to the north became the Mount McKinley National Park. Every year, hundreds of thousands of visitors flock to this park to catch a glimpse of a caribou or a bear, or if the weather cooperates, of the mountain. The park is slated to be vastly increased in size, both to the north and to the south, as part of the D2 land proposals. What changes will this bring? To find out, Alaska Review talked to Dan Kuehn, the park superintendent, and to Barbara and Bradford Washburn, two people who probably know more about the park and the mountains within it than anyone else. They spent 15 years making a now legendary high-scale map of Denali, and in the process, in June 1947, Barbara Washburn became the first woman to reach the summit of Denali. We also talked to two men who make a living guiding people up the mountains in the Alaska Range. Ray Genet, who's been doing it longer than anybody, and Jim Hale, who set up his own company after working for Genet. The guiding business is regulated by the Park Service, and both Hale and Genet are worried that a new concession system being worked on by Bob Gerhard, mountaineering ranger for the park, could hurt them badly. Climbing the big mountains in the park without a guide can be a risky business. To learn more about it, we located a group of six climbers from Colorado, the Basai Denali Expedition, and followed them from their preparations in Anchorage to the airfield in Talkeetna, and then to their arrival on Denali. Almost half of all expeditions fail to reach their goal. Some of them are seriously injured or are overcome with altitude sickness, and some of them die. 1976 was the worst year in history for accidents and deaths on the mountains of the Alaska Range. Four people died on Denali, and six more were killed on nearby Mount Foraker, a mountain 3,000 feet lower than Denali but harder to climb. 33 people had to be evacuated from the two mountains last year at a cost of $80,000 to the U.S. taxpayer. And yet this year, there have only been five evacuations involving six persons and no fatalities. What happened? Jim Hale thinks it's a matter of respect.
The problem, I think, was basically a change slowly over the years in the attitude of climbers toward Mount McKinley. People got the idea because some people would come off and have a very good expedition, say, with good weather and no real major problems. They'd come back and say, wow, you know, it was really easy. And then one of their friends would go up the next year and maybe they'd get their tails blown off in a major storm, but they can't come back and tell their friends that it was just such an epic because they'd look like a fool because their friend had such an easy time of it. So nobody ever said how bad it was. Everybody was always saying how easy it was. And it just kept going and going and going until people had the idea that you could walk up in tennis shoes and there was no real major problem, you'd do it in 2 or 3 days. And so naturally last year, they ran, even though with good weather, with only one storm all year long, people were falling off the mountain like flies. it's just basically because they underestimated the size, the altitude, the cold, any number of things that can happen. And then we've seen a big reverse from last year to this year because people have understood that they can't get away with that kind of stuff. And they're taking real good care in getting themselves off of the mountain. Most of the people on the mountain last year had no capabilities of helping themselves if they got into trouble. And most of the groups I saw this year could handle themselves very well. It was really a good thing to see.
Ray Genet thinks that climbers should be able to direct their own evacuations and pay for them.
This would be the primary thing, to be able to pay for your own evacuation. Then automatically the expeditions would try to cut down on the number of evacuation. You know, you don't go out of your way to try to bang up your car just because it's insured.
But Bob Gerhard isn't so sure.
A lot of people felt that climbers were irresponsible and should be paying their own way.
So, what's your view on that?
Mixed. I think that most climbing parties should feel an obligation to pay if they get in trouble. That's the way I feel. But then again, we are in the business of helping and, in some effect, rescuing many people. We search for lost children in campgrounds, or hikers, backpackers that get lost. We search for them. We provide first aid assistance to people injured in automobile accidents. And we don't charge them, so I hate to see climbers being singled out as one group that does have to pay their own way.
And Bradford Washburn thinks the whole rescue issue has been blown all out of proportion.
People in America get way, I think, too uptight about injuries and deaths. I mean, here, you know, one person is in trouble on McKinley, and the entire state falls apart, and hot muffins are dropped to them, and you have to, you know, there's a chance of your being hurt by this stuff falling out of the sky, and people fly up from Seattle to get involved in the rescue, where in Europe, between 400 and 500 people are killed in the Alps every year, and a death in the Alps doesn't even rate first page space. So I'm not advocating people going off and killing themselves on McKinley, but I still think that people are making this as a free choice of their own. They are taking chances. I personally think that they ought to assume a major responsibility in the cost of rescue.
After last year's disastrous climbing record, the Park Service decided to station two rangers at Talkeetna, since most expeditions leave from there instead of the park. The rangers can't order the climbers to do anything, but they can give advice on gear and safety and point out some of the things they ought to watch out for.
There's a real problem at the Southeast Fork in the past, at least, is that there are probably going to be close to 450 climbers go through that base camp this year. And so you can have real trouble with sanitation. There's about two central toilet areas that we ask everybody who goes there to use, because what's happened in the past is an expedition will fly in and dig an outhouse, use it for 2 days, move on up the glacier. The next week it snows a foot and that's covered up. Somebody else comes in and sets up their tent right on top of the thing. And last year we had a couple people who said they got sick because of that, you know. And that's a real loss. I mean, you know how much it cost you to get here and how much planning you do, and to get sick right there at the landing strip because somebody else didn't dig a proper outhouse is a real bummer.
The whole matter of garbage and human waste on the heavily traveled approaches to Denali reached crisis proportions last year, but since then things have gotten a lot better, thanks to efforts by climbers, the Park Service, and the pilots who constantly fly to and from the mountain, including Mike Fisher of Talkeetna Air Service.
It's not immaculate up there by any means, but it's much better than it has been. People are conscious of the problem up there. And even residue from expeditions of 2 or 3 years past is coming out of there now, because people are packing it out, bringing it down. And I think it's getting better, because the word is out that anybody who litters on that mountain is in serious trouble.
Finally, after 3 days of waiting for the weather to clear, the expedition was underway. Talkeetna is about a half-hour flight from the southeast fork of the Kahilna Glacier, a landing strip first used by the legendary pilot Don Sheldon, who found it with the help of Bradford Washburn. This landing site is ideal because it is just outside the McKinley Park boundary. It is against the law to land an airplane inside the park for anything other than an emergency. But the Kahilna Glacier may soon be inside the park when it's expanded, so pilots and climbers alike are afraid they won't be able to land there anymore. Mountaineering ranger Bob Gerhard says he doesn't think that that's a problem.
I would suspect that the way it will be is that a few landing strips will continue to be allowed because of past traditional use, and the southeast fork of the Kahilna would certainly be one that I think will continue.
We discovered that the glacier has a couple of full-time summer residents, including Frances Randall. She runs a CB radio for the air services in Talkeetna. An experienced mountain climber herself, she says she's seen it all.
Right in here, you meet people from all over the world, Japanese, Mexico, Switzerland, Scandinavia, England, Bosque, I think, four climbers from Bosque. They were the most, probably the most picturesque of all the climbers. And then some of them just absolutely come to the mountain unprepared, like these people from Kansas. They had no idea what Arctic conditions were like and how high the winds could be and how cold it could get and how quickly the weather can change.
If you had any words of warning or advice to someone with not too much mountain climbing experience that wants to come up here, what would you tell them?
Oh, golly. Come spend the winter in Fairbanks.
Before leaving the mountain, we talked to Glenn Fortner, leader of the Basai Denali expedition. What was the toughest thing about getting this whole thing together, making it happen?
Getting the bucks up. To get here, it's a long way from Colorado to get here. We've come a long way in time and expense, not just in space. It's a long way from there, but the distance amounts to money more than anything else. And we're awestruck by this mountain. We're not going to take it lightly. None of us has ever seen anything quite like the magnitude of these things. So it's got all our respect. And these guys are doers.
No, there aren't any tea bags here. Why don't you go and look for some? This water's about ready. It's boiling pretty good.
Why don't you put some more in there?
Yeah, maybe I will.
You need to go to the water mill soon?
Yeah. See if you can find those tea bags.
We're all recommending expeditionary mountaineering. We're out here to find out if we like it or not. Carrying the loads and stuff. Relatively high degree of suffering involved in climbing a big mountain. It's not all, daredevil, hard moves, and glamour and all that thing that mountaineering has sort of come to be. There's a whole lot of just one foot in front of the other and breathe hard.
What do you see as the real challenge or responsibility as the leader?
The thing that I think about most, I think, is in terms of leadership responsibility, is delivering 60 fingers and 60 toes back to these men's wives in Colorado intact.
And so we left the climbers, confident, physically strong, with plenty of the right gear and a reasonable amount of mountain climbing experience. Just 2 days later, things began to fall apart. Jim Mason announced that his heart wasn't in it, that he wanted to go down. Nothing the group said changed his mind, so Wolfgang Lenhart said he would accompany Mason off the mountain. Fortner told us he thought that was the hardest thing that Wolfgang had ever said. Now reduced to only four, the expedition managed to reach its advanced base camp at 14,000 feet on schedule on the eighth day. Then the weather went bad and stayed that way. 3 days later, they decided to make the climb to 17,000 feet anyway. With 40-knot winds literally blowing the climbers off their feet, it took 17 hours to make the climb, a 17-hour day they never recovered from. By the end of it, they were all suffering from altitude sickness. Just 3,000 feet from the summit, they huddled in their tents day after day, and the weather never got any better. Scotty Jackson said he wanted to go down. So did Mike Hamrick. Randy Ice still wanted to try going up, and so did Glenn, but they needed a good day to do it. They never got it. Finally, on the 17th day, they agreed to all go down because Glenn couldn't split the party up. And so ended the Basai Denali expedition. Basai is Japanese for to penetrate a fortress. For these climbers, the fortress could not be penetrated. But Glenn Fortner did get all those fingers and all those toes back home in one piece. About a third of all successful climbs are with professional guides such as Genet and Hale, but they're just the Alaskan guides, competing with others who come up every summer from the lower 48. Within the next 2 years, the Park Service plans to issue an exclusive guiding concession to one or more companies, replacing the current practice of issuing permits to any qualified operator. Bob Gerhard was quite evasive about who would get that concession and how many companies would share it.
We don't have to cut it down to one. There can be as many concession permits as there are special use permits now.
Do you expect that that would be the way that it would finally end up? That whoever is working the mountain now gets to keep on working there?
The concession permits will be issued for a 5-year period. I don't think that all of the people operating now will want to go into a permit for that length of time. I think there will be fewer concession permits than there are special use permits, but I don't really want to commit myself any more than that.
Specifically, are you going to be showing any kind of preference to Alaskan operators versus outside operators when it comes to issuing permits for concession?
No, we won't.
Jim Hale is concerned that a concession would result in just Denali being climbed to the exclusion of the hundreds of other peaks in the park.
If the concession idea does go through, it's going to be, I don't think, a very good idea, especially for a singular or even maybe two or multiple concession, because the park itself, and it would be a concession for the whole park, is just too large for one group to really be able to use it at all. There's nobody that can really handle the thing at all. And most of the other guide services are focused only on the west buttress of Mount McKinley. And so it would be a real injustice to have one guide service do that and guide nothing but McKinley when there are other possibilities in the other parts of the range.
And Ray Genet sees the concession as just another example of government interference in his affairs.
The idea behind this is probably to limit the amount of people climbing, more control by the national park over the operator's actions as far as the number of people he's going to take there. There would be more control. You know, like any government contract, it's going to be a pain in the neck. It'll be a bureaucratic morass to go through.
It should be remembered that the climbers are but a tiny fraction of the total number of visitors to the park. 500 a year versus 500,000 a year who arrive at park headquarters by car and train. They surge into the overcrowded facilities at the park hotel, shop for souvenirs, and climb into the shuttle buses for the ride into the park. Ironically, they'll have only a 30% chance of seeing the mountain the park is named after. The superintendent of the park is Dan Kuehn. He says that things should get better if Congress approves the expansion of the park.
The purpose of the northern expansion is to provide for a more complete ecosystem for the existing park wildlife. As far as the southern extensions are concerned, the main purpose there is to preserve that tremendously scenic area that comprises the southern part of the McKinley Massif.
The present plan, which is largely based on, let me call it what I call it, ecomania. It's just keeping everybody away from this close-up experience, so that a relatively small number of people can go in there and enjoy being sure that we're not there. And this is not the way a park system should be run, to put it very bluntly.
Bradford Washburn is director of the Boston Museum of Science. We caught up to him in Anchorage checking his latest work, which involves taking aerial photographs of Denali on 8x10 negatives from a Learjet. Both he and Barbara feel strongly that the park should allow better access for visitors, especially for older people. Dan Kuehn assured us that the South Addition is being designed with just that in mind.
We feel this would be an ideal situation for a major development, to improve the Peters Creek Road, extend it the 5 or 6 miles necessary to get into this area, to provide a major campground development, hotel accommodations with a variety of prices to accommodate all ranges of the visiting public. This would be the place to view the mountain. In addition to that, we would contemplate constructing a visitor center facility with exhibits, etc. Perhaps a trail where people can walk alongside the glacier. And again, with this just tremendous view right up to the summit of McKinley.
I am absolutely positive if the state, through its park system and the national park system, work together in concert, that something of great quality can be done here. Because remember, there's nothing else, I've said this before, I repeat, there's nothing else anywhere on Earth where as near a great center of civilization as Anchorage is, and Anchorage is a step from Tokyo or Seattle, that you can actually get face to face with a mountain 20,000 feet high. Remember, the highest cliff on Everest is 9,000 feet. The highest cliff on McKinley is 14,500. You've got something pretty unique here. Share it with everybody.
This is the Killer Whale Clan House, one of several clan houses in Clukwan. The artifacts and art pieces that have been used by the people in these houses are now major artworks worth hundreds of thousands of dollars. Are these just artifacts of a dying culture, or are pieces like this still being used by Alaskan natives? A look at Clukwan and the selling of the whale house when Alaska Review continues.